worship. We're going to worship if you guys would stand. We're going to lift up Jesus' name in this place, and we're just going to praise his name. Let's put our hands together.
Your name, your cross, our freedom, our hope. We lift your name.
We sing higher.
Amen. Praise God. Good to be in church this morning. Praise God. Now, if this is your first time worshiping with us here at Family Life Church, we'd like for you to look in the little pocket in the back of the chair and see a card like you see on the screen behind me. And if you'll be so kind to fill that out, and at the conclusion of the service, take it to the Next Steps table out in the lobby. We have a gift for you. Folks, let's let our first-time guests know how excited we are to have them with us this morning. Those that are watching online, if you look at a link in the description, you'll see the same thing. You can fill it out online. And then on another matter, if you've been attending Family Life Church, and you know this is where you want to serve the Lord, this is you're going to make it your church home, you need to go through Connect Point. Connect Point is where you find out what your gifting, spiritual giftings are. And we talked to you about the vision of our church to reach the lost for Jesus. So you need to go through Connect Point. We're going to be having one this afternoon at 4 o'clock, but you need to sign up at the Next Steps table as well. And then the next item here, our youth are going to the 12 conference. This is a very life-impacting conference. Notice the price tag, $325. If you'd like to help with that online, with online giving, there's a little tag there. You can click on it and help contribute toward that, and help some young people to go be a part of this conference that'll be coming up later this summer. And then for those of you that brought your tithes and offerings this morning, as you exit at the conclusion of the service, on your left, you'll see a gray drop box up on the wall. We like to say right here, because God gave all, we can be boldly generous. Amen. Those watching online, there's a link in the description for giving as well. And we want to give our best to God, because he gave his best for us. Amen. Everybody ready to continue? Start worshiping again? Let's do that. Amen.
You are who he says you are.
Thank you for accepting us, God, despite, Lord, allow us to be available for you, to be open, so you can use us, God.
Narrow as the road may seem, I'll follow where your spirit. I will give you every peace.
Hallelujah.
You know, something I think about is how the God we serve created the entire universe. He formed the stars and the planets and the galaxies. He set the laws of physics into motion. But yet Scripture says what God cares about most is our heart. Can you allow just that love of God just to soak in this morning? God, we thank you for who you are. And we praise you. We give you all the glory. And God, this morning we declare that we are available. So Holy Spirit, come speak to our hearts. Come speak to our lives. God, we need you. We need you more than ever before, God. We need you. And so, God, we give it all to you. We give you the praise. And God, if there's anything in our hearts that is keeping us back from being able to experience your fullness, God, we give it to you. We break it down in your name. We say, change us from the inside out. Change us from the inside out, God. We give you all the praise and all the glory. And everyone said, amen. Come on, somebody, find someone sitting near you. Tell them it's good to see them in church today. And you may have a seat. Thank you, worship team. Cool deal, cool deal. Well, y'all, hey, it's so great to be here with you guys today. And for all those watching online, we love you guys. Glad you could join us as well. And so if I haven't met you yet, my name's David. I'm one of the pastors here. And it's a joy to be with you guys. And I tell you what, man, I just love Sunday mornings. I don't know about you. I just love Sunday mornings. I just think there's a special level of love and joy that comes when we come together to worship God as a body. And I want to share a few pictures with you so you can share my joy as well. You know, we've been talking about how life groups are starting. And this past Tuesday, we had our first life group of eight. And this is one of our ladies groups, and we have a few more as well. And the thing I want to share with you guys that brings a lot of joy to my heart is that this past Tuesday was the largest life group event we've ever had here at Femi Life Church. Can we give God some praise? Yeah, look at them good-looking guys right there, man. Now, we ended up having something like 40 people out, and it was a great time of not only developing relationships with one another, but growing closer to God. And, you know, we had one guy in my life group that he told the group, he said, listen, I need this life group. I've been missing this the last 9 weeks that we haven't been meeting together, and I am so happy to be with all of you guys tonight, because he said he needs life groups. And there was another lady, she's newer to the church, I mean, like the last, been here less than a month, I think, and she came in, and her first time going into a life group, and so she didn't really know anyone, really, and she went into the life group, and afterwards, when they were coming out, one thing that brought a lot of joy to my heart is she was walking with another lady who's been coming to the church for a while, and you would have thought they were best friends. You know, I just love seeing the relationships that are building here at Family Life Church. And let me tell you, if you're looking to build some relationships to grow closer to God, be here Tuesday night, 6 p.m., free dinner, free childcare, no excuses unless you got to work, all right? Then you got to talk to your boss, all right? So, but anyways, I just want to share that with you guys because it's one of the main four things that we do, one of the four things that we do, and it just brings a lot of joy to my heart. But anyway, so today we're going to continue in our series that we're calling James. Now, James is one of the books of the New Testament. It was written by Jesus' half-brother, and the thing that's really cool about James is that he just lays out how to follow the teachings of Jesus in everyday life. And so we've been having a lot of fun with this, and if you were here last week, you may remember that James got a little nosy. He got prying into our lives, and the question that he asked the early church was, is your walk matching your talk? And so we had to explore our hearts as well and say, okay, are we being authentic in our faith? And what James talked about was that those who have authentic faith, that there is signs that there's good fruit that accompany that authentic faith. Well, today we're going to be looking at the application of that as James continues writing. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to James chapter 3. We're going to be starting in verse 2. And let me say, today's message is going to be one of the most relatable messages that you're going to be able to get out of the scripture, because it's something that if you're like me, you deal with on a daily basis, which is I have to deal with my big fat mouth. Let's see what James has to write to us. James writes, starting in verse 2, he says that we all stumble in many ways. Amen. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. Let's pause there. Pretty much what James is telling us is that if you can get that scoundrel inside your mouth under control, then all that other stuff you deal with, piece of cake. He continues and he says, when we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal, or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great force is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body and sets the whole course of one's life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. He says all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. Think about that. But I'm going to guess that none of you guys would put poison in your kids' food. But what if the words we speak are poison to their heart? Continuing, he says, with the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. He says, my brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Now listen, this could be the first time you've ever heard the scripture in your life, and you don't need a commentary, you don't need a dictionary, because we all know what James is saying right here. Because we all know how it feels to say things that we regret. We all know how it feels leaving a conversation and mentally just beating yourself up. Come on, man, why'd you say that? Oh, come on, that was a secret, I shouldn't have said that. Oh, that wasn't the right words to use. We all know how that feels, right? You know, I think about when are the times that we tend to say things that we regret the most? Well, I can think one of the times we tend to say things we regret is when you're stressed or frustrated. Don't raise your hand, but how many of us have a stressful job or a boss who causes us to get super frustrated? Yeah, I remember with Brittany and I mean, we got small kids, and small kids, man, they know how to push some buttons. And I remember we got to a point where the tone we were using with each other, and we were just weren't being very nice, and we had to stop and say, wait a minute, why are we talking to each other like this? And what we identified was that the times when Brittany and I, when we were saying things that we shouldn't be saying to each other, was because we were stressed out or we were frustrated. You know, I think about another time we tend to say things that we shouldn't say or we regret is when we're angry. Don't look at the person sitting next to you. But you guys ever notice how, like, our brains, it's almost like it has, like, this bank vault of memories that you don't think about very often. But yet anger is like a key that unlocks that bank vault. And when that person you're fighting with, when they make you angry, that door comes open. And you can remember every bad thing they ever did, every negative thing they ever said to you, and you bring it right back to the surface. I know that's none of you guys, though. I think the third time we tend to say things we regret is when we get excited. A little bit different, right? But listen, we know how it goes. You get with your siblings, you get with your cousins, or you get with your best friends, and you just start chatting it up. Man, you're having a good time, you're laughing, you're sharing stories. And then an hour later, you're like, okay, why in the world did I just let that come out of my mouth? Isn't there something about when we get excited, the filter goes away? And then you go back to the mentally slapping yourself. Psh, shouldn't have said that. Nope, that's just for me and my husband to know. Nope, I shouldn't have done that either. But we all know how it feels to say things we shouldn't say and say things we regret. And listen, I'm right there with you all. I could write a 12-volume series of all the things that I wish I wouldn't have said. I'll just share one with you, okay? But here's the promise you have to make me. You can't judge me, okay? But back when I was in college, there was a girl coming to the church that I was going to. And I found out she had a crush on me. And so I said, okay, well, hey, let's go on a date. And so we went on a date. And after that date, I knew I never wanted to go on another date with her. But you know what I told her? Later that day, she called me and said, hey, oh, I had so much fun. We should do this again. Now, if I would have been honorable, I would have said, hey, listen, no, let's just be friends. I said, let's pray about it. For 3 weeks, I said, let's pray about it. For 3 weeks, see what God says. Folks, I never prayed once about it. I said, you can't judge me, y'all. You can't judge me. Well, 3 weeks comes up, and she's all excited. All right, I prayed about it. And I'm like, okay, yeah, me too. And yeah, I don't think God wants us to date. I mean, like, come on. Like, listen, if you didn't grow up in the church world, you know, when you were growing up, you probably just said something like, oh, my mom said I can't go, right? You know, but you know, in the church world, what do? You pull the God card. And you know, I look back, and I feel bad about that. You know, that was so mean, you know, pulling out that God card on her. I should have just done the honorable thing. Well, we all know how it feels. You guys are like, man, Brittany, you have a lot of courage to be with that guy. But, you know, we all know how it feels to say things we shouldn't say. But you think about how many relationships have been broken because we said an ill-timed statement. How many fights could we have avoided if we would have shut our mouths? How many sleepless nights could we have regained? How many guilt-ridden thoughts could we have negated? If I could just watch my big, fat mouth. Listen, this stuff matters. This is important. I mean, Solomon writes about our words like this. He says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. And those who love it will eat its fruits. This is important. Why? Because as all of us know, the way we speak matters. The way we speak makes a difference. And God knows this. This is why God loves us too much. He loves us too much to stay silent on this issue, so he inspires James to write about this. The way we speak matters. And God wants us to live our life to his promise, up to his standard, so he wants to help us do this. And so he inspires James to give us a big truth, which he gives us in three analogies. He talks about how, going back to James, he says we put bits into the mouth of horses to make them obey us, and that ships are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go, and that a great force is set on fire by a very small spark, that the tongue is also fire. What is James trying to teach us? What is so important about the way we speak? In your notes, the big truth I want you to understand is that our words carry prophetic power. Our words have the ability to speak something into existence. See, some people, when they think about prophecy, they think about just being able to foretell the future. But prophecy is also being able to speak something into existence. And I'm going to demonstrate it for you. I'm going to go ahead and bring the table up here. But we got to think about the prophetic power that our words have. Are we speaking blessings or are we speaking curses? And it will dictate how the lives around us will be impacted. Thank you. So there's three types of prophetic statements that we need to understand. And when we understand these three prophetic statements, it's going to give us a roundabout understanding to make sure that we're using our words the right way. And so we can control that big old fat mouth of ours. And the first type is what we call direct statements. Now, I think we understand this pretty easily. I mean, this is just simply when I look and talk to you and say something about you right to your face. And I don't know what kind of upbringing you had, but some people had some really rough, have had some really rough things said over them. Whether it's a boss at work or a bully at school, maybe it was neglectful parents. Curses or blessings, they have prophetic power. And you think about the effect that they have on our lives. Think about speaking over somebody and saying, where did I mess up with you? Or speaking a curse over someone and saying, I wish you were more like so-and-so. Or imagine a direct statement such as, you're ugly, or you're stupid, you're annoying. Think about other direct curses that people will speak over a person. These statements have a power. And the thing is that these, they're not independent statements. When you look at the course of someone's life, we need to understand that these curses can domino into each other and cause somebody to hit rock bottom. You think about it, this is where Satan wants us to be. This is Satan's plan for your life. He wants to see you in shambles. He wants to see you without joy, without purpose. But we know this is not where God wants us to be. But sadly, too many of us know how it feels to be like that. To every morning having to pick yourself up off the floor because of curses that someone has spoken over you. The first type of prophetic statements we have is the direct statement, when we speak directly to somebody. But I think that one's pretty easy to identify. But I think we can be very conscious of that. And like, we know when we're doing that. But there's a second type of prophetic statement that we have to be very mindful of, because this one's easy to slip and we don't even realize what we're doing. And this is the indirect statement. These are the sly comments that we make to people. We don't even realize the effect that it's having. For example, it could be something like, imagine that someone tells their son, you can't trust those women. Or imagine a mother telling her daughter, oh, you gotta be careful around men because they only care about one thing and one thing alone. All guys are the same. And we think, oh, no, I'm just trying to warn and prepare my kids for the real life. Well, how are those indirect statements going to impact their worldview? Are you robbing them of intimacy that they might be able to enjoy in their marriage one day? Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't be cautioning our kids about the real world, but we have to make sure that we're speaking the truth. Or how about racist or sexist jokes? Oh, we're just having innocent fun, but is it really? Maybe for you, you don't think it's anything big deal, but you may not realize that over time, jokes like that can set an ungodly stereotype into people's minds. Yes. They're indirect statements. Or how about things like perfectionism? You know, maybe someone isn't speaking directly to you, but we all probably know how it feels. Maybe you've had a boss like this. Maybe you've had a parent like this, where they're just constantly criticizing every little thing you do. Maybe they don't tell you you're not good enough, but by their comments, they're telling you you're never going to be good enough. If I had a fifth block, I would put in here pride. How many of us know somebody who they're never wrong? Like, listen, you can show them the facts and they're going to find a way out of it, right? But they're never willing to admit that maybe they were wrong. That's a sign of pride. And when you grow up in or you're around an environment like that, it can rub off and create pride inside of you where you're not willing to just say, hey, I'm wrong, I apologize. And what we don't realize is maybe that some of these indirect comments, that they're not just independent statements that don't relate to each other, but in fact, when they work their way into our hearts, they produce the domino effect as well. It can lead to the same place. Are our words leading towards death, or are they leading towards life? Our words matter. Our words matter because they have prophetic power. But there's one more, and this may be the most relatable for some people. Because the third type of prophetic statement is the personal statement. These are the words that we speak over ourselves. And we all know people who speak curses over themselves. say, oh, you'll never be good enough to be invited. Or there's just something wrong with you. You'll never be one of the cool kids, right? You know, you're not pretty enough. You're just not funny enough. You know, you can never be yourself because no one will accept you. And you start declaring curses over your own life. Now, of course, we need to understand that whenever someone does this, it's not because it just happened out of the blue, right? This doesn't happen overnight. This happens after years of direct and indirect curses being spoken over somebody. And we see the results. See people with low self-esteem who hate themselves. People who are always pessimistic. We see the results of this. People who feel like they always have to put a mask on, that they can never be authentic. They can never open up. They can never trust somebody. But it's because there's been curses that has been spoken over them and that they eventually speak over themselves. Our words carry prophetic power. But here's the good news. Just as our words carry prophetic power of cursing, our words also carry prophetic power of blessing. Our words can also carry the power of life. So how should we use our words? Well, Paul gives us the instruction in Ephesians 4:29. He says, don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up. So what's the application? How do we use our words? Well, there's a slogan one of my favorite pastors uses, and I've never forgotten it. And you're never going to forget it either after I tell you. But simply, be a hope dealer. Now, you heard that, right? Be a hope dealer. You'll just be dishing out that hope everywhere you go. School, work, around the kids, with your family, even your in-laws. Be a hope dealer. Just deal that hope everywhere you go. Be a hope dealer. Start speaking words of life in the people. And think about the difference it will make. You know, you don't know what the person you're talking to has gone through. You don't know what kind of thoughts that they have going through their mind. You don't know the battles they're going through internally. But start speaking words of hope. Maybe you tell somebody, listen, you are so loved and wanted. You know, maybe you tell someone, hey, I can see how God has created you like this. That's beautiful. Hey, I just want to let you know that I believe that God has a plan for your life. Don't give up. Don't let this mistake control your future. And you start speaking words of hope. And what happens is you start turning something that would have been a curse into a blessing. And then the devil doesn't really have much to work with anymore, does he? But it happens when we speak words of hope. We break the curse by replacing it with the truth of God. And let me tell you, when you do speak those words of hope, make sure you base it on the truth of God for them, because then it carries spiritual weight that we can't get from human wisdom. Now, also, let me caution you, don't lie. Listen, if you got a kid and they're just a straight C student and they try their hardest, but they're just not very good at schoolwork, don't go to them and say, hey, you're going to be the top student in your class. So it's like, well, that's not how prophecy works. But maybe you find something else. Hey, I see how you have such a kind heart. We need more people like you. Hey, I can see how you're such a hard worker. You know, listen, you just trust in God and he's going to take you places you can't even imagine. But you start speaking those words of hope based on God's truth. And the beautiful part is you plant a seed in that person's heart. And who knows what God will do with that. So I don't know about you, but I believe God can do more with us than we can do with ourselves. But we got to plant those seeds of God's truth in their heart. If you understand, say yes. So let's start speaking those words of hope, and let's see how God uses that to change people's lives. I'll survive and come back up on the keys. So I want to share a story with you guys. Because I believe this stuff works. I've seen this stuff work. You know, I believe that when we start being hope dealers, that it changes the environment that we're in. You know, I think about not long ago, I got a haircut, about time to get another one again. And you know, you've seen in the movies, the barbershops, and how people interact in barbershops, and it's actually pretty accurate. You know, people, you know, you get a whole bunch of guys together in a room, and they just start talking. And so I was getting my hair cut, and I was up on the chair, and, you know, guys are talking about this, talking about that. And I remember I mentioned that my wife and I were going to be having our third child, and it's going to be another boy, and now we're going to have three boys under the age of three once he's born. Which elicits this normal response, which is, you're going to have your hands full. It's like, yes, we know. But I don't know, something about that stirred up some thoughts in people's minds. And you remember how earlier I said, you know, when people get excited, they start losing that filter on their mouth? Well, that's just kind of what happened in the barbershop. Like, people got excited, people start sharing stories, and then next thing you know, they just start letting things come out of their mouths. Different guys were talking about how they remember when their kids were so small and how annoying it was. Certain guys started talking about how, oh, they hated being woken up in the middle of the night. And one by one, they just started sharing negative story after negative story after negative story. And if I were to be honest, I was in there too. I've shared a few things as well. Oh, it's so annoying when they do this. This is a whole atmosphere of negativity. And I remember I looked over, and two chairs down, there was a middle school age boy sitting there. And I remember just feeling that gentle rebuke from the Holy Spirit, saying, what are you doing? And I thought, what kind of impression is that young man getting about himself? What kind of impression is he having for maybe parenting in the future? Then I thought to myself, I need to deal some hope out. And so when I had a chance to talk, and I just mentioned, I said, you know, it's going to be a handful, we know. But I tell you what, my favorite part of my day is when I come home from work and the boys go, Daddy! And they start running, big old smile on their faces. And I get down and I get them both in my arms and I get to hold them. And they're just so happy to see me home from work. And I told them about how much joy I get from that. And how I know that season's going to be over before I know it. And I'm going to cherish every single moment. And then something changed. Instead of these guys speaking curses and complaining, they started sharing stories about how much they love their kids and their grandkids. It was incredible how the whole room, the atmosphere changed. That's what hope does. Hope is contagious. But we have to start the cycle. Let's be hope dealers. And let's see what God does with that. Now, whenever we speak a curse, or whenever we say something we regret, where does that come from? Well, Jesus says this. Jesus says, what you say flows from what's in your heart. So whenever we say something we shouldn't say, or say something we regret, that's a time for self-reflection. That's a time to ask, okay, where did this really come from? And if we have to be honest with ourselves, then we have to say that maybe there's something inside me that needs healing. But here's the beautiful part. Here's the good news. Scripture also tells us that God heals the brokenhearted and he binds up their wounds. That's the God that we serve. That's the God that we serve. You know, this Tuesday when we get together in our life groups, everyone's going to get a special handout that's going to give everyone an exercise of how you start rebuking the curses that have been spoken over your life and start replacing them with God's truth. God wants your soul to be healed. But God doesn't want us to do it alone. That's why as a church, we get together. God uses people to do miracles through. God has called us to be his hands of healing to this world. So let's start being hope dealers. Let's start receiving that healing that God has for us. I'm going to ask if everyone could stand. Listen, the greatest healing that we can receive is a spiritual healing. For those who have accepted Christ into their heart, you've already received it. But Scripture tells us that every single human on this planet, that we're born with a broken spirit. It's a spirit that's been corrupted by sin. And Scripture tells us that if we never find healing for our spirit, then at the end of this life, we don't get to be with God in eternity. But God loves us too much, and so he created a path for us to be able to know God, to have that spirit literally replaced with a new one. And that new spirit inside of us guides us and helps us to become the image of Jesus. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here this morning, you say, Pastor David, I need that healing in my spirit. You know, if you say, Pastor Dave, I've turned my back on God. I haven't committed my life to him, but I know I need to make him the Lord of my life. Today could be that day. The Bible says that God's already done his part and that God's already there knocking on the door to our hearts saying, let me in. Allow my healing, my presence to come into your life. And for those who have experienced the life change of God, they'll tell you how it's just like this fresh breath of air that comes in. You can imagine just coming from a musty, dark room and opening a door and being on top of the mountain with that fresh breeze coming in. That's how it feels when God comes inside of us and changes us from the inside out. Scripture says that we receive that through grace, that you can't be a good enough person. None of us can be. But it's because God loved us enough to send his son Jesus to die for our sins, and God raised him from the dead 3 days later. That's the love that God has for you. So God made a way for us. So today may be that day where you say, I need to commit my heart to God. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're in that place right now, I want to say a prayer with you. This is just between you and God. Just in your heart, say, God, I believe you exist. And God, I believe you sent your son Jesus to die for my sins and that you rose him from the dead 3 days later. God, I ask for forgiveness of my sins. I invite you in. Change me from the inside out. And today, I make you the Lord of my life. It's in the precious name of Jesus. And I just want to say a quick prayer over everyone else in this room right now. Today's subject was a hard one. It's one we deal with all the time. And I just want to pray that God will give us wisdom and strength. God, you see the hearts and the souls here this morning. And right now, through your Holy Spirit, we just pray that your wisdom would flood our hearts. We pray that you would give us discernment to see when our words are being used for life or when they're being used for cursing, and help us to only say words of life. So through your Holy Spirit, we know that you have given us the power of self-control so we can be who you've called us to be. So use us, God, for your glory to make a difference in this world. We give it all to you. In the precious name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. Come on, can we celebrate some people today? Amen. Hallelujah. If our tone setters could go ahead and get back into position. For everyone else, we're going to dismiss in just a second. But if I could have my prayer team go ahead and come up here to the front. Every week, we love to have our prayer team up here at the front because we know that life can be tough. And so if you're going through anything, if you need just another someone agreeing with you in prayer, our prayer team is going to be up here. And as soon as we dismiss in a moment, they're going to be ready for you guys. All right? But let me say this, if you made a decision to follow Christ today, in the back of every chair, you'll see an I Have Decided card. If you made a decision, we want to know about it so we can celebrate with you. So if you fill that out, bring it to myself, Pastor Charles, you put it in the Dropbox, and we just want to celebrate with you and connect with you, that's all. And for those watching online, there's a link in the description you can use with the digital connect card as well. Amen. Well, we got two things before we go. By show of hands, how many people got kids in here? Anyone got kids? Oh, lots of people all over the place, yeah. Yeah, well, hey, listen, in 2 weeks, we're going to have something really fun because all the parents know that in 2 weeks, you're going to have to go find a babysitter because school's ending. So we love to celebrate that with you. We're having a pop-up Sunday, in two weeks from today. It's the first Sunday after school gets out. So if you have a child in one of these three areas, the first one being a pre-K going into kindergarten, if you have a fifth grader going into middle school, or a 12th grader who's graduating into paying taxes, then we want to celebrate with you. So this is what we ask that you could do. If you have that child, we want to celebrate them on that Sunday. We'll do it both services, but we also want to give them a gift. And so if you could just let myself know if you have a kid in that age group so we can make sure that we have a gift ready for them, because that's going to be really awkward. They come up here and like the first six people get and they don't get one. That's going to be real weird. All right, so let us know so we can have that ready for them. Amen. And last but not least, we have our after party out there in the cafe. It's a free snack that you can grab to hang out and get to meet some other people before you leave. Amen. How many people were touched by the Holy Spirit this morning? Well, let's give it up for God. Well, thank you guys for being here. We'll see you guys next Sunday. You are now dismissed. Come on, let's put those hands together right here.